Dear students, this is our third chapter of first book of history class 12th, Kinship, Caste and Class. Again, period is same between 600 BCE to 600 CE. Mahabharata, a colossal epic. The Mahabharata is one of the two major Sanskrit epics of Indian history, the other being the Ramayana. It narrates the struggle between two groups of cousins in the Kurukshetra war and the fates of the Kaurava and the Pandava princes and their successors along with the epic Ramayana. It forms the Hindu Itihasa. Two armies fought, one of which was extremely large and the other was significantly small. Many important people died, and even during the war, troops were continuously being added. You can make out yourself that this was a colossal war. It was also epic because His Almighty Lord Krishna was Himself involved in this war. Critical edition of the Mahabharata. In 1919, under the leadership of a noted Indian Sanskritist, V.S. Sukhtankar, a team of scholars initiated the task of preparing a critical edition of Mahabharata in India. Initially, they collected Sanskrit manuscripts of the text, written in a variety of languages from different parts of the country. Then the team compared verses from each manuscript. Ultimately, they selected the verses that appeared common to most versions and published these in several volumes. These were total 13,000 pages. And this project took 47 years to complete. There were several common elements in the Sanskrit version of the story, also evident were enormous regional variations from Kashmir to Tamil Nadu in the way in which the text had been transmitted over the centuries. These variations were documented in footnotes and appendices to the main text. Finding out about families. Families are usually parts of larger networks of people, defined as relatives, or to use a more technical term, kinfolk. We notice that not all families are identical. They vary in terms of number of members, their relationship with one another, as well as the kinds of activities they share. Often people belonging to the same family share food, resources, work, and live together and perform rituals together. While familial ties are often regarded as natural and based on blood, they are defined in many different ways. Some societies regard cousins as being blood relations, whereas others do not. For early societies, historians can retrieve information about elite families fairly easily. It is, however, far more difficult to reconstruct the familial relationship of ordinary people, because we had information of elite families, but we do not have much information about ordinary people. Remember, the ideal of patrilineage. First, you understand what is patrilineage. Patrilineage means tracing descendant from father to son. grandson and so on. And what is matrilineal? Matrilineal means when descent is traced through the mother. At one level, the Mahabharata is a story about patrilineal. It describes a feud over land and power between two groups of cousins, the Kauravas and the Pandavas, who belong to a single ruling family, that was Kuru. Under patrilineal, sons could claim the resources of their fathers when the father died. Most ruling dynasties from 6th century BC onwards claim to follow this system, although there were variations in practice also. Sometimes there were no sons, then brothers succeeded one another, and sometimes other kinsmen claimed the throne. In very exceptional circumstances, women such as Prabhavati Gupta exercised power. The concern with patrilineal was not unique to ruling families only, but also in ordinary families. Rules of marriage. There were two systems of marriage, endogamy and exogamy. Marriage within the kin is called endogamy, and marriage outside the kin is called exogamy. The lives of young girls and women belonging to elite families were often carefully regulated to ensure that they were married at the right time and to the right person. This gave rise to the belief that kanyadan, or the gift of a daughter in marriage, was an important religious duty of the father. There are three types of marriage. Monogamy. It is the practice of a man having one wife. Polygamy or polygyny. It is the practice of a man having several wives. And polyandry. It is the practice of a woman having several husbands. From 500 BCE, marriage norms were compiled in Sanskrit texts known as the Dharma Sutras, Dharma Shastras, and Manusmriti. These texts recognized as many as 8 forms of marriage. Of these, the first 4 were considered as good forms of marriage, which were arranged by the parents of the boy or girl, while the remaining 4 were condemned, which were not fixed by the elders, parents. It is possible that the last 4 forms of marriage were practiced by those who did not accept Brahminical norms. The Gotra rules for women. One Brahminical practice was to classify people in terms of Gotraj. Each Gotra was named after a Vedic seer, and all those who belonged to the same Gotra were regarded as his descendants. Now, there were 2 rules about Gotraj, particularly important. First one was, women were expected to give up their father's Gotra and adopt that of their husband on marriage. And second rule was that members of the same Gotra could not marry. Some of the Satvahana rulers were polygynous. The queens who married Satvahana rulers indicate that many of them had their father's Gotra even after the marriage. What is also apparent is that some of these queens belong to the same Gotra. As is obvious, this was opposite to the ideal of exogamy recommended in the Brahminical text. In fact, it exemplified an alternative practice, that of endogamy or marriage within the kin group, which is prevalent amongst several communities in South India. Satvahanas also had marriage relations with Shakas, who were considered as outcasts. Social differences, caste system in India. The Dharma Sutras and Dharma Shastras also contained rules about the ideal occupations of the four categories or Varnas. Brahmanas were supposed to study and teach the Vedas, perform sacrifices and get sacrifices performed, and give and receive gifts. Kshatriyas were to engage in warfare, protect people and administer justice, study the Vedas, get sacrifices performed and make gifts. The Vaishyas were expected to engage in agriculture, pastoralism and trade. And last one, Shudras were assigned only one occupation, that of serving the three higher Varnas. In that way, the whole Varna system was divided into four classes: Brahmana, Kshatriyas, Vaishyas and Shudras. On the basis of Purusha Sukta, few scholars are of the view that caste system is given by the God. According to Purusha Sukta, Brahmanas were originated from the mouth of God, Kshatriyas from arms, Vaishyas from his thighs and Shudras from his feet. The Brahmanas evolved many strategies for enforcing right occupation norms. One was to assert that the Varna order was of divine origin. Second, they advised kings to ensure that these norms were followed within their kingdoms. Third, they attempted to persuade people that their status was determined by birth. They also reinforced these norms by stories like Mahabharata and other texts. On the basis of division of labor, modern historians are of the view that caste system originated due to division of labor. Powerful and healthy persons were given the work of protection of the country. According to the Dharma Shastras, only Kshatriyas could be kings. So a specific caste of soldiers, Kshatriyas, was originated. In this way, yajnas could be performed by only few people. These people became Brahmanas. People engaged in trade and agriculture were called Vaishyas, and those who served these three castes came to be known as Shudras.